Well, it really began with the report of the Senate of Canada on euthanasia and assisted suicide. And there was no unanimity about that particular topic. But there was total unanimity on the fact that Canadians weren't dying well. And that's what got me engaged in the whole issue of how we could bring some political presence to the issue of death and dying in Canada. When I was asked to be the government leader of the Senate, I then went to the Prime Minister and I asked if I could also be known as the Minister with Special Responsibility for Palliative Care. Mr. Chrétien didn't understand why I would want to be known as the Minister with Special Responsibility for Palliative Care. So I explained it to him, and he knew of the report in 1995. He also knew that there had been a subsequent report of the Senate in 2000. And I said I thought there was an agenda that I could push while I was the minister. But my primary responsibility was running the Senate. And so I had to ask my employees, none of whom, by the way, were going to be paid out of a budget for palliative care, if they would go on this journey with me. And every one of them said yes. We were able, as a group, to move in four important areas. The first was to move the budget for research from about $900,000 a year to $16.5 million over the next 5 years. We were able to introduce the compassionate leave benefit, and I was able to persuade the College of Physicians and Surgeons that doctors needed to be trained in palliative care. As a result, since 2008, there has been no undergraduate physician who has graduated from a Canadian medical school without a core program in palliative medicine. In terms of the final thing, of course, it was finding money, of all places, from the Western Economic Diversification Fund to fund the Canadian Virtual Hospice. Well, it's very personal, as it is with almost everyone that has been engaged in the whole process of death and dying in Canada. My parents both died in the same year, in 1980. My father had had a stroke and had lived for 10 years with that stroke. But after he died in May, we realized that my mother had literally given her life in the care of her husband. And she died 7 months later of congestive heart failure. But when I admitted her to hospital at her request, because she came to live with me in her last few weeks, she had a do not resuscitate order, which they didn't respect. And so that is where my passion comes from, that if you've had an experience like that, either with the good death of a family member, and I did have that with Dad, because he had had 10 years we didn't expect him to have, and then a bad death with my mother because her wishes were not respected, then I thought there's got to be a better way in Canada. They were lucky. They had financial resources. But they still weren't able to find people who could care for them the way they needed to be cared for. And most of my parents' children did not live in Halifax where they lived. The two that were there provided what care they could. But it can be an insurmountable burden for families when people are facing those issues on a day-to-day basis, particularly someone with a chronic illness like a stroke. One of the stories that certainly stays with me is the story of a baby being brought into the Vancouver Hospice, Canuck Place. It was in 2000, and it was a baby that was clearly dying. And the parents had made the decision that they didn't want her to die in hospital, they wanted her to die in a special place. So they called the hospice, and the arrangements were made for this child to die in her parents' arms while walking through the rose garden. And you cannot, until you had seen it yourself, realize the enormous peace on the face of these parents. Now, everyone knew they were going to have enormous grieving, but their daughter died. They knew she was going to die, but she died in their arms in a special place. And so for me, the Rose Garden became symbolic with the kind of care that's often provided in hospice and in hospitals and in long-term care facilities and in homes. It's allowing someone to die in a rose garden. Well, the first report was Quality End-of-Life Care, the Right of Every Canadian. That was 2000. The second report was 2005, still not there. And this last report, which we've entitled Raising the Bar, identifies, quite frankly, that yes, we have come a long way. I mean, when we identified the need in 1995, we knew that about 5% of Canadians were having access to quality end-of-life care. We know now that it's probably, for cancer patients, as high as 35%. For patients dying of ALS or Alzheimer's or COPD or all the other things that people die from, it's still very low. So, yes, we know how to deliver it. We know what needs to be done. But even in our best estimates, only 30% of dying Canadians have access to it. Palliative care essentially began as a treatment for cancer that could not be cured. And so the difficulty, quite frankly, throughout the entire passage of time has been to make it available to those that don't suffer cancer. Cancer's a relatively easy thing to define. Generally, you know the trajectory, you have some idea of the amount of time left. For many of these other illnesses, you don't. And so when governments put up policy saying, yes, palliative care should be available for the last 6 months of life, or the last 3 months of life, or the last 6 weeks of life, whichever they happen to have decided, it probably only suits the cancer patient. It doesn't suit all of those others whose trajectory is not nearly so simple. It doesn't go down in a fast line. It goes up and down. There'll be good weeks and bad weeks until the end is mostly bad. And that's when they have the most desperate need for palliative care. But of course, in my view, they've needed it all along so that they could help come to terms with the fact that they do have a life-threatening illness. They don't know when that life-threatening illness will have an impact, but it's there. It's going to happen. We found that it particularly has not worked for parents with children, even though they may have cancer, because it requires a definition that there is a likelihood of death within 6 months. Parents won't admit that, and so they don't apply. And I don't blame them. Interestingly enough, when we designed the scheme, we had pediatricians on the board that helped us come up with this definition, but it became evident within 6 months that it was simply not working. The definition was wrong. We had to use terms like gravely ill in order to address the needs of those particular parents. And unfortunately, it hasn't been changed since it became law in 2004, and it desperately needs that change. It also needs to be longer. Two things have happened. First of all, you have young physicians who actually know what palliative care is and know what they don't know. And that's as important sometimes as knowing what you do know, because they can now go to specialists in palliative care, although we don't recognize palliative care as a specialty, but there are definitely specialists across this country in palliative medicine. And they can go to them for help and guidance and support. So that's very important. But the other thing that has happened is that the residents who, 1995, 2000, perhaps two of them a year in a teaching hospital were asking to do a rotation in palliative medicine. Now 60 or 70 of them are asking for a rotation in palliative medicine. So having introduced to them at the undergraduate level a program, they have taken interest in that program and they've wanted to learn more. And that's what it was all about. And often nurses say, well, what about us? Well, the reason we targeted doctors, because we knew we could only do so much in a short period of time, was that when we examined the statistics, if a nurse was offered a course in palliative medicine, 80% of them took it. If a doctor was offered a course in palliative medicine, 20% of them took it. And they were the gatekeepers. So if you couldn't get the gatekeepers to accept the need for palliative medicine, then it wasn't going to happen. The nurses would quickly follow, and indeed they have. Caregivers are the unsung heroes and heroines in Canada, and I'm talking about family members and volunteers. They are the individuals who make palliative care happen in Canada, and the physicians and the nurses and all the other specialists will tell you that. They couldn't do what they do without those volunteers. And yet there's no recognition by governments at any level of the contribution they make. So there has to be a significant change in the way we deal with caregivers in Canada if we want people to have good death experiences. We need to educate Canadians about what is death. You know, I got an honorary degree several years ago at a medical school at the University of Manitoba. And I said to them, what I hope for you in your future is that when a young person, all bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, goes into their first day of medical school and they're told they're going to be taught everything about curing, I also hope they're going to be told everything about dying. Because all of your patients will die. And that is something doctors don't want to admit. Canadians don't want to admit. We are an exclusively death-denying society. But you know, 100% of us will die. I think we have to deal with it in our schools. Children know about pets dying. You know, they flush the goldfish down the toilet. They know things die. They've had animals that die. Why don't we ever talk to them about their grandmother dying? Because that will happen in their lifetime, when, you know, at least in 98, 99% of the cases. But we don't talk to them. And we need to. I gave a speech not too long ago at a grand rounds in a hospital in Ottawa. And I asked at the end of the speech how many in the room had advanced directives. About a third of them. Now, these are doctors and nurses that deal with death and dying every single day, and yet they haven't got their head around it. And I think if I asked a normal audience, the percentage would be significantly smaller. You know, I've had it in my own family where we've had two critically ill individuals, neither of them with a will, neither one of them with an advance directive, and their mother's been working in the field for 15 years. I mean, they do now, but only because they were faced with an emergency situation. And so we have to have the dialogue. We have to have the discussion. Oh, I think we can be extremely proud of the compassionate care benefit. I mean, it's one of the few in the world. And those that have adopted it from the Canadian model. So yes, we should be very, very proud of the compassionate care benefit. We should be very proud of the fact that our physicians are now getting core programming in palliative medicine. We should be very proud we've moved the bar from 5% to 30%. But what about the other 70%?